Honors. May it please the Court. My name is Daniel Shaw. On behalf of JC and his family, I apologize at the onset. You might hear an occasional cough or sniffle. My lovely 10-year-old brought me home a wonderful cold this week. The central question in this case is whether or not children with disabilities and their parents are afforded the procedural safeguards found at 1415 of the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, that is, their right to due process, to challenge the level of services and other rights required by state and federal law when those services are being provided by California Children's Services, CCS. CCS has taken the position the king can do no wrong. CCS thumbed their nose at the mediation process at the administrative level by refusing to participate. They thumbed their nose at the office.
You know, that's all rhetoric. Well, let's talk about the statute.
Absolutely, you're right.
Yeah, let me ask a question.
Yes.
Thumbing the nose is not helpful to you. The California government code, I think section 7575, seems to say, you know, pretty clearly that the Department of Health Care Services is to determine whether a child needs medically necessary services, and that CCS is to provide medically necessary services, quote, by reason of medical diagnosis, unquote. So, I mean, how does that leave any room for an ALJ to determine what is medically necessary?
Yeah, I think what the court needs to understand is that a child only qualifies for CCS pursuant to a medical diagnosis. In terms of services in a student's IEP, we refer the court, as we did in brief, to 7572C3 and 7586, which makes it very clear that any and all disputes and all issues are resolved through the due process procedures set forth in
7586. Any and all disputes was with respect to related services.
Yes, correct, Your Honor. And if you look at the very first paragraph of Chapter 26.5, it specifies that the chapter was enacted for the purpose of assigning joint responsibility between the two departments for the provision of related services in the form of occupational and physical therapy services for the purpose of ensuring a free and appropriate public education was provided to JC in this case.
And would your reading of the statutes render redundant CCS's own appeal process then?
CCS, I think the court needs to understand, CCS is a program that existed, that's existed for many years. They provide numerous services to children who qualify for their program. Only a small percentage of those services are occupational and physical therapy services. All the regulations and all the law that has been cited by CCS certainly apply to those services provided through the majority of their program. However, what Chapter 26.5 did was it assigned joint responsibility to CCS and the Department of Education for the provision of related services, a term only used in special education law, a term only found under the Individuals with Disability Education Act. And
so the answer to my question is?
I'm sorry, what was your question?
Okay. I mean, would your reading of the statute render redundant CCS's own appeal process?
I don't believe CCS's appeal process applies in this case. It's certainly not due process consistent with 1415 of the federal law.
Well, let me ask it a different way. Would students who receive CCS services as part of their IEPs be able to choose which system of review to use?
No, Your Honor. The services included in an IEP would be challenged appropriately through the procedural safeguards found at 1415 as well as 56500 of the State Education Code.
They couldn't go through both? I mean, because it seems like here in this particular situation, it was a question of medical necessity, wasn't it?
Well, I think the problem with going through both is that both processes are completely different. California elected to participate in IDEA, the Individuals with Disability Education Act, and as which the statute allows states to assign responsibility for the provision of special education services amongst its agencies. The purpose of doing this, and the site for that is 20 United States Code 1412A12A. The purpose is to allow states to maximize already existing programs they have in an effort to ensure children are provided appropriate services. a state may only receive federal funding under IDEA if it has in place effective policies and procedures that ensure, amongst other things, number one, a student is entitled to a free or has access to a free and appropriate public education, and that children with disabilities and their parents are afforded the procedural safeguards found in Section 1415 of IDEA. And if you look at those procedural safeguards, what it entitles a parent to when there's a dispute between, as to a level of service between a parent and an agency, a public agency, they have the right to be represented by counsel. They have a right to an impartial hearing officer to hear the case. They have a right to compel witnesses, cross-examine witnesses, and ultimately they have a right to appeal the decision if they disagree with the outcome.
Here's a question I've got. As I read the statute, the ALJ has jurisdiction over, quote, related issues and related, or rather related services, excuse me. And related services appears to be defined as including physical and occupational therapy, quote, as may be required to assist a child with a disability to benefit from special education. That is to say, related services include therapy, but only insofar as it's educationally relevant. It does not say as is medically necessary. So, if I'm reading it that way, if there is a situation in which some physical therapy is medically necessitated, but is not educationally relevant in the way described here, does the ALJ have jurisdiction to say this is medically necessary, even though it is not a related service as defined here?
I believe Judge Castillo, in his decision, made it very clear that he wasn't determining the level of medical necessity, and he artfully gave examples of situations in which a service provided by CCS might be medically, purely medical in nature. He gave the example of a child with an injured leg who required physical therapy in the form of massage therapy. It had absolutely no nexus or connection to the education. In JC's case, he has a severe orthopedic impairment. He's bound to a wheelchair, mostly for life. And the ALJ also gave examples when it's almost impossible to separate out what's medically necessary from educationally necessary.
Yeah, no, I'm not sure I understood your answer. Maybe I can focus the question and then focus the answer more.
Yes.
It seems to me that if something is simultaneously medically necessary and a related service in the sense that it's required to assist a child in order to benefit from special education, well, the fact that it may be medically necessary doesn't take it out from under the definition of related services.
I believe that's correct, Your
Honor. So far, so good.
Yes.
Is there ever going to be a case when something is medically necessary but is not, quote, required to assist a child to benefit from special education?
Yes, I believe the example.
And what happens in those cases?
In that case, then I don't believe OAH would have jurisdiction to determine the level of service that's purely medical in nature. I think that falls outside of their jurisdiction.
So the ALJ does not have jurisdiction over that?
That's correct.
Okay. What would that be? What's the example?
The example would be a student who had an injured leg and required massage therapy as a form of physical therapy.
And so what happened here? What did the ALJ say? They just say the ALJ says this is both a related service in the sense that it's required to assist the child in benefit from special education. It may also be medically necessary, but that's neither here nor there from my jurisdiction.
That's exactly what the ALJ said, Your Honor. I also want to point out, and I think this is important for the court to understand, the district court erred in dismissing all the issues in our case. The district court did find that OH did have jurisdiction over CCS as a public entity involved in the decision-making process for JC, but they dismissed all the issues in the case, and that was an error. One of the most important issues was the issue of an independent assessment. In our case, we had raised the issue against CCS that they failed to comply with the procedures of independent assessments. We prevailed on that issue, and as a remedy, we were awarded a reimbursement for two assessments that the parent had privately paid for. If you actually look at the Chapter 26.5, specifically Section 7572C, it specifies that nothing in this chapter shall prevent a parent from obtaining an IEE, which shall be considered by the IEP team, which would include CCS as a related service provider. It's important to understand that the determination of that issue had nothing to do with medical necessity. This was purely a procedural violation, which we prevailed on, which was dismissed at the lower level. I do understand in brief that CCS has attempted to argue that we didn't pick a person that was consistent with their criteria, but I think the court needs to note that they waived that the right to challenge that issue because they didn't appeal the underlying issues in the case. In fact, at the district court level, on the record, they specifically stated that they were not appealing any of the ALJ's ruling, that they weren't disputing the fact that JC required additional services. It was just their opinion that it wasn't their responsibility. It was the school district's.
Can I ask you for another example? And I just want to make sure I understand this. When will occupational therapy be necessary or services be educationally necessary but not medically necessary?
When would they be educationally but not medically? I think it's hard to separate out the two. I think in a situation, I got to think about this for a second, holding a pencil, I think would be purely educationally necessary. Yes? I understand the point the court's trying to make. I think at the end of the day, what the court needs to understand is that for 40 years, parents have had a right to challenge the level of services under federal law that are contained in a student's IEP. And for the first time in 40 years, a parent has been told that they cannot do that. And that is in violation of the IDEA, and it puts at risk California's funding under the statute because they have to ensure parents have a right to due process to challenge the level of service contained in a student's IEP. I know I have 3 minutes left, so I'd like to reserve that for rebuttal.
Okay,
thank you.
Good morning. May it please the Court, Deputy Attorney General Hadara Stanton, on behalf of the Director of the California Department of Healthcare Services. This Court should affirm the District Court's order and judgment. The District Court correctly found that the Administrative Law Judge lacks the authority to order the Department of Healthcare Services to provide more services than the California Children's Services Program had determined were medically necessary.
Well, what if the ALJ says, well, you talk about medical necessity. I'm talking about this is a related service which is educationally required.
The California Children's Services Program only provides services that are medically necessary.
And they cannot be required by the ALJ to provide the services that are required under the IEP, even if those are related services such that they are educationally required.
That is exactly correct, Your Honor. They may not be ordered to do so. And that is because...
No, that doesn't strike me as a very sensible reading of the statute.
That could be, but let me clarify something. The California Children's Services Program only provides medically necessary services. Any services beyond that amount that may be required for the student to access their educational needs must be provided by the local education agencies. Now, in this case, had the parents disputed the medical necessity determination by CCS, they could have appealed that determination by obtaining an independent medical expert at CCS's expense to determine whether the student needed more services than were medically necessary.
This is one of the three. They could pick one of three experts.
Exactly, Your Honor. Of physicians. And then on the other hand, a question of whether the services are necessary for the child to access their education must be provided by the local education agency if there is a dispute. And that is intended to ensure that a child doesn't go without the services, the occupational or physical therapy services, that may be necessary for their educational needs.
Well, that seems to make sense, and I understand that. That's why it seems like what the district court decided, you know, seems rational and reasonable. But I'm having just trouble because there are several provisions that seem to contemplate, when you read it, subjecting disputes over related services to due process hearings. And it seems like related services are quite clearly defined to include occupational therapy services. So I just try to figure out why shouldn't, and maybe you can help me answer this question, why shouldn't disputes over occupational therapy services
be subject to review in a due process hearing?
So let me break Your Honor's question down into two pieces. First, there is no dispute that occupational and physical therapy may constitute a related service under the IDEA, such that a student with special needs would be entitled to it for provision of their free and appropriate public education. However, state and federal law mandate that those services must be provided by the local education agencies. And in fact, here, appellants settled with those agencies, the entities legally responsible under state and federal law, to provide any occupational or physical therapy that may be necessary for education services. They settled and they agreed to the level of the occupational and physical therapy necessary for his educational needs. Then they turned around and sought occupational and physical therapy from California Children's Services Program. The California Children's Services Program, as counsel mentioned, has been in existence for almost 90 years, well before the IDEA, well before the Medicaid Act. What the California legislature has clearly done, they have recognized that in some cases, children who receive special education services through the public education also receive medically necessary services from CCS. And in recognizing that there may be overlap and that there may be multiple entities responsible for ensuring that a student receive their necessary services, they expressly delegated responsibility. And in that case, the local education agencies are responsible for providing any services, occupational therapy or physical therapy, pursuant to Government Code Section 7.
In what case? Would you say in that case, in what case?
In a situation where, and I understand the court is struggling with the question of, is it medically necessary or is it educationally necessary, and what did the ALJ do below? However, and perhaps this will answer the question, in this situation, what the ALJ did was he exceeded his authority in that his jurisdiction under the regulations governing a due process hearing, wherein occupational and physical therapy are in dispute, he is mandated to rule according to Government Code Section 75, 75A2. And in that provision, the legislature clearly stated that any services, and this is only occupational and physical therapy services, in those services that the California Department of Health Care Services has not determined to be medically necessary, they shall be provided by the local education agencies. This is clear. Now, in this case...
Yes, I'm reading kind of along with you. It says not deemed medically necessary by Department of Health Care Services, but you often get directions that say to the agency, you decide this. But, of course, that doesn't mean that an ALJ reviewing that decision is bound by the decision. So the question really is whether that determination initially made by the Health Care Services can be reviewed in the due process hearing by the ALJ.
And the answer to that is no.
Because
the medical necessity determination, the California Children's Services Program is a state program. It is administered by the Department of Health Care Services with its partners in the counties. They have, under the Health and Safety Code, they have strict requirements that must be met before they may provide CCS services. And again, we need to be very careful to distinguish the physical therapy and occupational therapy that CCS provides is not in the case of a broken leg. These are for severely handicapped children, and California pays for their medical care.
Yeah, I mean, basically this, when you really come down to it, this is a fight between the state government and the local government as to who's going to pick up the cost. And the argument here is that the ALJ gets to decide that question, and you say that Health Services gets to decide that question. I mean, that's the sum and substance of what we're talking about.
Respectfully, I would disagree, Your Honor. And the reason for that is because medical necessity determinations is reviewed by CCS through their process.
Well,
the question of what the...
And it may also be, and this is the question in front of us, being reviewed by the ALJ.
Well, Your Honor, the Department of Health Care Services disputes that the ALJ had the jurisdiction to review.
When they're tied to educational questions, or to educational necessity, and even though the language and statute seems to give them authority over it. So I understand, and I understand why the district court did what it did, because it read, medical necessity one way and saw the wording in that 75-75 and said, okay. But when you look at related services and how it's defined and to include occupational therapy, I'm just trying to figure out when California Fair Law defined related services, because it seems like it's under both, to include occupational therapy. You seem to say that they are excluding medically necessary occupational therapy for purposes of that definition, and I'm just having a little trouble understanding why or how you get there.
Okay. And we briefed this below, Your Honor, and that is the federal statutes exclude medical necessary services from related services. However,
medically necessary services if they are not educationally related.
Well,
that is to say, if something is both medically necessary and a related service in the sense of educationally related, it's a related service.
Correct. A related service is a statutorily defined term.
Right.
However,
and much of that related service may indeed be medically necessary.
I would argue that under the federal statute that if it's medically necessary, it is excluded from the IDEA. However,
I just don't read the related services definition the way you do.
And fair enough, and I would argue that's not actually even an issue here. And in this case, the issue is that the administrative law judge had no authority to rule beyond the requirements of the statute. And the requirements of the statute are, if occupational and physical therapy, in the abstract, is necessary for a child to access their educational needs, those services must be provided by the educational agencies. And the distinction here is that the California Children's Services Program...
I understand, but get to the part when it says, when they're also educationally necessary. Because then it says they're subject to a due process hearing.
And Your Honor, it's not... There is no dispute here as to whether or not the Department of Health Care Services is subject to the due process hearing. While we contend that they are not, the district court didn't find in our favor on that respect. So that the question of whether the ALJ had jurisdiction over the department isn't the question. The question here is whether the ALJ had the authority to order the California Children's Services Program to provide additional medically necessary services. Again, this is at a level beyond what was incorporated into the child's IEP. The child's IEP provided 45 minutes of occupational therapy a month. There is no dispute that the CCS program provided that. However, what the ALJ then did is he heard testimony from the department's physician, because again, CCS can only provide services when a CCS physician has approved those services as being medically necessary for a child's CCS eligible medical condition. So he heard testimony from the physician. He heard the testimony brought by appellants, experts who are physical therapists, occupational therapists. Again, under California law, they are forbidden from prescribing. That authority is limited to physicians. And in the case of CCS, the authority to order CCS services is limited to CCS physicians who are themselves defined under statutory authority. And then he made his own determination as to what he believed student required to access his education.
Here's my problem as a practical matter with the position that your department is adopting. I come back to what I said before. I think at bottom, this is really a fight over who pays for this, whether it's paid out of your department or whether it's paid locally. If the ALJ is bound by the determination by your department that they're not paying for it, if your department is having budgetary problems and they don't want to pay for a bunch of stuff, their decision, I'm not paying for it, is simply unreviewable. So they can lay it off on the locality and nobody can tell them otherwise. That's the consequence of your position.
However, that's not an issue here.
That's the practical consequence down the road of your position.
With all respect, Your Honor, the practical consequence here is that the California legislature was very conscious of these overlapping responsibilities.
Well,
let me address...
Please, you're not addressing my question. You're saying the legislature was conscious, da-da-da-da-da. I'm telling you, as I read this statute the way you want to read it, it gives your department the ability to say these are not medically necessary. They may be educationally necessary, the such related services, and the decision of your department that they're not medically necessary means that by necessity they're going to be paid by the locality, and your position is that decision by your department is not reviewable, which then gives your department the ability in an unreviewed fashion to lay off these expenses on the locality. Is that not the consequence of your position?
Not entirely, Your Honor. And the reason is that under the IDA and state statute, the local education agency must provide it in order to avoid the child going without services. But then, that educational agency has numerous remedies to obtain reimbursement, to obtain mediation against the state agency that that local entity believes is responsible for paying for it.
And so what are those procedures?
It's a state mandate procedure. It's set forth in, I believe it's section, Government Code Section 7585. But the problem in this case...
Can you tell me how easy those things are? That strikes me as cumbersome and uncertain.
I couldn't say, Your Honor, but the counties and the state go through that process on a repeated basis. And again, there is...
On a case-by-case basis?
Well, on an ongoing basis, that's how it operates.
I asked on a case-by-case basis, do they do that?
I would imagine, but I couldn't say. But there's also, under the government code provision, a due process proceeding as between the local education agency and the state agencies to determine this, and it's an expeditious process. Here, however, the appellants settled with their local education agency, dismissed them. They were the only entity legally responsible under state and federal law to provide services that may be educationally necessary but not medically necessary. They dismissed them. They settled. They said, we agree to your level of services that you'll be providing. And then they moved forward against the CCS program under the rubric of the IDA, seeking more educationally necessary services. But CCS may only provide services that its physician has determined are medically necessary. And there's no dispute here that CCS did that. They provided those services. What they are disputing is that the ALJ had the authority to order CCS to provide more services than the physician had prescribed as being medically necessary to treat this student's medical conditions. Now, I think the confusion, not confusion, but I would say the difficulty in this case, is that there's occupational therapy and physical therapy no doubt could enhance a child's educational needs. There can be no dispute as to that. However, the only services that CCS provides are those that are medically necessary, those that are designed to treat the child's medical condition, not to assist the child in accessing his educational level at a level beyond that.
What happens when it's both?
When it's both, the decision of under the statutes, the decision of the CCS physician becomes the recommendation of the IEP team. And so then that does become reviewable under the due process proceeding.
Well, isn't it both here?
And respectfully, no, because here his IEP provided a level of occupational therapy and physical therapy. The ALJ then determined at the administrative hearing that the CCS program should provide him with more services for his educational needs. But there's no, that was not the determination of the IEP team. And the entity under the IDEA that would be responsible, again, is the local education agency. And so
it wasn't the recommendation of the IEP team, is what you're saying here, in this case.
His IEP included 45 minutes of occupational therapy provided by CCS and additional occupational and physical therapy provided by the local education agencies, the school districts. So he was receiving both.
The parents didn't think that was enough.
Well, questionable, Your Honor, because the parents settled with the local education agencies, finding that the level that the local education agencies was providing was sufficient for his free and appropriate public education. Then they turned around.
Wait a minute. They didn't say finding. They settled. That's different from finding.
Fair enough, Your Honor. Fair enough. And in that settlement, what they said was that the school districts would assist the appellants in going forth and obtaining more services from CCS through the due process proceeding,
right,
which I think brings us back to Your Honor's concern.
Yes, and that argument, of course, can be advanced to the ALJ, saying, hey, wait a minute, this is just an attempt to, this is a conspiracy between the parents and the local authority to extract money out of the state. And the ALJ can decide whether he agrees with that proposition or not.
And the problem is the ALJ's authority is limited under the regulations defining his jurisdiction. He is required to rule when there's occupational and physical therapy in order to avoid this conundrum. he's required to rule according to Government Code Section 75752, which says in this situation.
That just allocates the responsibility. That doesn't say what his jurisdiction is. That just allocates the responsibilities he's supposed to pay if it is or is not medically necessary.
The regulation that defines his jurisdiction, the California regulation, says that he must rule according to the Government Code provision that defines responsibility.
Which code is that now? Which statute? What language are you now referring to?
Well, it's the regulation that defines his authority in a due process proceeding.
Yeah, so what is that one?
Is that 42.40?
No, it's California Code of Regulations, Title 2, Section 60550, Subdivision E. It says, for hearings related to the provision of occupational and physical therapy, the hearing officer shall rule according to Government Code Section 7575A. And 7575A is the statute that defines for a circumstance where the department doesn't determine medically necessary occupational or physical therapy is required, but it is educationally required. It shall be provided by the local educational agency. And in other words, when a hearing officer rules in a due process proceeding that involves this question of occupational and physical therapy responsibility, the responsibility, if it's educationally necessary, is for the local education agency to provide it, and then that entity can then seek to recover if it believes that it should. However, in this case, and in the other administrative cases cited by appellant, the parents of students are settling with the local education agencies, agreeing to the level of services the local education agencies will provide, and then seeking to compel the Department of Healthcare Services to provide more occupational and physical therapy through the CCS program.
We're looking at the statutory language here, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
And would you say it's clear?
I would, Your Honor.
And then let me ask you, same question that was asked of your opposing counsel. I'm just curious, when will occupational therapy services be educationally necessary, but not medically necessary?
Be medically necessary, but not educationally.
No, well, I want examples of both, right. But the first one I'm giving you is, when will they be educationally necessary, but not medically necessary?
Well, I struggled with this question in preparation for the argument, to be perfectly honest, Your Honor, and I reviewed the determinations, the prescription by the CCS physician to try to understand what specific services we're talking about. I think the issue here is the medical necessity determination is a multi-part. It's not simply are they medically necessary or educationally necessary. For CCS to provide them, it must meet the multi-part requirements under the Health and Safety Code. And that is, the physician must assess the child, must determine that it's assisted toward relief of the medical condition. And I think Your Honor's question is a fair question, because arguably any service that we...
Don't you think that makes the statute less clear?
No, Your Honor. In fact, I think not only does it make the statute more clear, but it makes the statute more important. And that is because what the legislature said in defining this is they said the purview for determining medical necessity lies with the department, lies with the CCS physician. And to avoid putting administrative law judges in a position where they are determining for themselves what service is medically necessary, they're not physicians, to avoid putting them in that situation, the default is to say, CCS, your physicians, they assess the child. It happens on an annual basis. They assess the child, they assess their medical needs, the therapist makes a recommendation, and the physician writes a prescription. And so the determination of the level of services that are medically necessary is made by physicians. And then what the legislature did in enacting the statute, and the legislature was well aware of the requirements of the IDEA and the Medicaid Act on the different state agencies and local agencies here. And so what they said was, in this situation, in this precise situation, any services that the Department of Healthcare Services does not determine to be medically necessary under the requirements. Again, the child has to have a CCS-eligible medical condition. They have to be evaluated by the CCS physician. The CCS physician has to determine those services are necessary for the child's medical needs. That decision stands. They can review it by obtaining an independent medical assessment through the CCS program. Or if those occupational and physical therapy services are necessary at a level beyond that, then they're provided elsewhere, and it takes the question of medical necessity out of the ALJ and puts it rightfully where it belongs under the Health and Safety Code with the Department of Health Care Services. The CCS program only provides services that are medically necessary, and the statute sets forth what it needs to consider to determine them.
You know, you cited the regulation, and I'm now reading it, 60550E, as something supporting your argument. You have it right there in front of you. I'll wait till you find it.
Thank you.
We're taking you over, but don't worry. There's some difficulties here, and we'll just talk as long as we need to. See when you're there.
I'm there.
Okay. Subsection E begins, the hearing officer shall be knowledgeable, blah, 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 for hearings related to the provision of occupational and or physical therapy. The hearing officer shall rule according to Government Code Section 7575A, which specifies, notwithstanding any other provision, and this is the provision that we've seen earlier, that says that health services is supposed to provide medically necessary therapy.
Yes.
That, as I read that, that goes directly contrary to your position, because that tells me that the ALJ has jurisdiction over this question.
Well, again, the question of whether the ALJ has jurisdiction over this question the district court ruled against us on that question, so I'm prepared to concede for purposes of this argument that the ALJ had jurisdiction to rule on this question.
The district court said they didn't have jurisdiction.
So these are, may I clarify, Your Honor?
Uh-huh.
So we argued below, as we argued to the ALJ, that the ALJ had no jurisdiction over the Department of Health Care Services. It was the sole respondent in this administrative hearing with the parents before the administrative law judge. And what we've argued and what our position is that the Department of Health Care Services is not the proper respondent because the Department of Health Care Services doesn't provide educational services. It provides only medical services.
Now, we're talking a different sense of jurisdiction. What I'm talking about is not, as it were, in personam jurisdiction. I'm talking about subject matter jurisdiction. As I read this, this tells me that the ALJ has subject matter jurisdiction to rule on the scope of subsection A of 7575 with respect to whether or not these services are medically required. That's how I read this section. It seems pretty clear to me.
May I offer my...
Yeah, please, because obviously you disagree.
Slightly, Your Honor. And the reason I say that is the question, what the ALJ doesn't have jurisdiction to do, according to my read of this regulation, is to rule in a manner that's contrary to Government Code Section 7575A2. And what that section, as we've all talked about, I don't think I need to repeat, it defines the allocation of responsibility. So what this regulation provides is that in a case where there is a question of occupational or physical therapy, it essentially says the Department of Health Care Services shall be responsible for the provision of medically necessary occupational and physical therapy by reason of medical diagnosis and when contained in a child's in the pupil's IEP. In this case, we have the department's determination that the medically necessary level of occupational and physical therapy was 45 minutes to be provided by CCS, 45 minutes once a month. That was by reason of a medical diagnosis, and it was contained in the child's IEP.
I just read it differently. As I read it, it said, for hearings related to the provision of occupational and or physical therapy, the hearing officer shall rule according to Government Code Section 7575A, which specifies, and that basically summarizes to some degree, quotes it. Well, as I read that, it tells me that the ALJ is entitled to decide, empowered to decide, authorized to decide, or required to decide how these two provisions apply to the case at hand. And how they apply to the case at hand includes a decision as to whether or not these services are medically necessary. Boom, end of story.
But what the administrative law judge did was he made his own determination.
Well, yeah, okay, that's what he's supposed to do. He's supposed to decide whether or not they're medically necessary.
But he decided what he believed would be educationally necessary.
Well, of course, he decided, number one, they're educationally necessary. That gives him jurisdiction because it's a related service. And then he decides, okay, and within this category of educationally related services, this is medically necessary, so you pay for it.
Would you like me to respond?
Oh, yeah, please. Yeah, yeah. Because if I'm right, you're wrong.
So if I may, I would like to respond. Again, and it's important to even look at the provision above that, where the part where it talks about the hearing officer must be knowledgeable about Chapter 26.5. Again, we must be quite aware of the fact that this CCS program, established in 1927, was then incorporated into the government code defining allocation of responsibility in what's called Chapter 26.5. And it was very clear that CCS only provides medically necessary services. But what the legislature understood was that many times these services are interrelated. The provision of services for special education, for children requiring special education in the public schools, may be provided by a variety of entities. And what might be helpful, again, Your Honor, is the interagency agreement that the California Department of Education and the California Department of Health
Care. It's pretty far afield from the words of the regulation I just read you.
But
I'm trying to put you in context.
You make a reference here. Are you saying that the ALJ was not knowledgeable about the provisions of Chapter 26.5 here?
I wouldn't say that, but what I was trying to explain.
That they relate to Chapter 26.5.
Yes, and that they're all intertwined, and that it must be that the legislature, quite mindful of all these intricate pieces, was very mindful of how the different requirements played out. And thus, I believe Section 7575A2 is very clear on this.
And is there anything in the legislative history that would shed light on this and that would support what your view is?
I believe it's clear in the statutes. And I think, again, the statutes, the IDEA that provides for the state agencies to determine the allocation of responsibility, then the interagency agreement, which is part of the record, that sets forth this understanding that it's a complex system and that CCS is required for providing. So because, again, CCS provides these medical services to children regardless of whether they're in a public school or not. So in order to maintain the CCS program and the integrity of the program to provide services for all children who need it in the state of California, but also recognizing that there is an overlap for children in public schools who may require some of these services for their educational needs, the interagency agreement specifies the allocation of responsibility. So to answer, to bolster my perspective on this, Your Honor, I think the regulation that defines the administrative law judge's authority sets forth that the administrative law judge must rule according to the dictates of what the legislature required and cannot deviate, cannot order the Department of Health Care Services to provide services that the educational agency must be responsible for providing for purposes of education.
That makes perfect sense, but you're arguing in addition to that the ALJ doesn't get to disagree with your department as to whether or not it's medically necessary.
That is correct, and the reason for
that's your bottom line, and I just don't see that the ALJ is allowed to look into the case, allowed, even required to apply the section, but not allowed to disagree with you, as he's, you know, what ALJs do is that they disagree with people who come in front of them.
I understand, Your Honor, and I would just, in a small response, point out that the requirements of the California Children's Services Program are set forth in the Health and Safety Code, and those provisions we cited in our brief, those set forth the requirements for the CCS program. And again, there is an opportunity for review of the medical necessity determination, but that is outside the purview of the ALJ.
Okay. Any further questions? We apologize for taking you so far over.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Response.
Thank you. What I want to point out is direct the court's attention to the interagency agreement between the CDE and the Department of Health Care Services, which we referenced at ER 367. It specifies that the department agreed to, quote, monitor the delivery of services by county CCS after the decision of the fair hearing officer to assure compliance with the decision, end quote. It's very clear in the interagency agreement that the Department of Health Care Services agreed to be bound by the ALJ's determination, and as Judge Fletcher pointed out, we interpret these specific regulations the very same, that the ALJ does have jurisdiction to make a determination, and he did in this case. Regarding settling the case with the school district, you know, my job as an attorney representing students is to get services to students as quickly as I can. In this particular case, the school district engaged in the mediation process. IDEA is prefaced on the basis of encouraging parties to resolve these disputes as quickly as possible. In 2004, the act was reauthorized to include a resolution process. It was essentially a second step for trying to resolve these cases, with the idea of getting services again to students as quickly as possible. CCS refused to participate in that process, and so as a result, we had to deal with the school district. We certainly did not agree with everything we got out of the settlement, but we did what we could, which what we thought was in best for JC, and then we moved forward with the remaining entity in the case. I also would like to point out, in regards to how these determinations are made within the context of due process, we need to understand that an IEP is an individualized education plan, and each student has individual needs, supports, and services, and nothing in the statute, nothing in Chapter 26.5, disavows a parent of their right to go to due process and ask a judge to make a determination as to which agency is responsible for what service, and that's precisely what we did in this case.
The opposing counsel highlights that the provision of, I guess it's the Reg 60550, talking about due process hearings, and that's paragraph A under that provision, references Chapter 26.5. What's your response that because the principles, I guess, or the information in Chapter 26.5 is supposed to be rolled in into this particular provision, the result should be the other way here?
I'm not sure I'm following the question, Your Honor.
Well, she discussed you have provision or Section 60550 in front of you.
I do not, but I'm familiar with the section.
All right, well, paragraph E, which she was just talking about, says the hearing officer shall be knowledgeable in the laws governing administrative hearings. In addition, the hearing officer shall be knowledgeable about the provisions of Chapter 26.5 of the Government Code and applicable laws. And I believe, if I understand, Ms. Stanton's arguments with respect to that, that, you know, Chapter 26.5 is significant, or the reference to it is significant, and should therefore make a difference here on what the ALJ is and is not able to do.
I think if you look at the underlying ALJ decision, he wrote a very lengthy decision where he analyzed Chapter 26.5 and discussed the statute extensively. He also discussed the IDEA and the federal law and how that relates to the determination in his case, so I don't think it was ignored. I think there was a lot of discussion in his decision regarding the provisions of Chapter 26.5.
And so then ultimately, I mean, I still struggle with, did the legislature really intend or contemplate giving two options of appeal here? That's something that seemed right that they would, that the people would get to choose between either going of choosing one of the three, you know, doctors and experts, or, you know what, go to the ALJ in a due process hearing, and if I lose here, then maybe go back the other way. I mean, right now, the reading that you want us to adopt would allow for that, and I'm still struggling with that.
Well, let me provide an example. What if in the case that JC attempted to use the procedure set forth by CCS, which is not due process, you select a name off a list, and then whatever recommendation that person makes is what you're stuck with. What if that had resulted in a lowering of services for JC? I mean, the purpose of due process under 1415, under 56500 of the Education Code, is to allow a forum for evidence to be presented, for people to be represented by counsel, and for a decision to be made. It's a very impartial process, and I think it's a very important process.
I'm still not sure that, you know, be very unique So I'm just trying to figure out what to do there.
Understand. To follow on from Judge McHugh's question, review for me so I understand what that avenue is within the healthcare services department, for which your adversary argues is the only avenue you get. So how does that one work?
My understanding, and I'm not intimately familiar with it, but is the parent is provided a list of CCS panel physicians. They get a pick from the list of half a dozen or so individuals, and they go to that individual who evaluates their child and makes a determination as to whether the child should receive the same or less, and then the parent is stuck with that decision.
And that's what we see in 7575B. Is that what that reference is, or where's that come from?
7575B.
Well, I'm trying to figure out what statutory or regulatory provision is responsible for the procedure you just described.
I believe it has to do with the regs that apply to CCS under. I assume opposing counsel would be more knowledgeable about that. We didn't seek due process under that provision. We sought due process pursuant to our right under 56500 of the Ed Code.
And there's no requirement of this or administrative exhaustion that you need to do that before you can go to the ALJ?
No, Your Honor, this is the way we exhaust our administrative remedies, is through this process.
So, but what if someone had chosen that avenue and didn't like the result? Would they get to go to an ALJ at that point?
Presumably, I guess they could. I don't know if there's anything in the law that prohibits that.
Okay, but that's not what happened here.
No. What happened here was we sought due process through the Office of Administrative Hearings against both the school and CCS as a public agency providing a related service in a child's IEP to get a determination as to what was appropriate for JC. Thank you.
Thank both of you. A complicated case, and we appreciate the arguments on both sides.
Yes, thank you.
Douglas versus parents on behalf of student JC now submitted for decision, and that completes our argument calendar for this morning.